So you want to be a neurosurgeon. After all, it's super badass, second only to being a rocket surgeon. Let's debunk the public perception myths of what it means to be a neurosurgeon and give it to you straight. This is the reality of neurosurgery. Dr. Jabal, MedSchoolInsiders.com. Welcome to our next installment in So You Want to Be. In this series, we highlight a specific specialty within medicine, such as neurosurgery, and help you decide if it's a good fit for you. You can find the other specialties on our So You Want to Be playlist. A lot of you asked for neurosurgery in our poll, so that's what we're covering here. If you want to vote in upcoming polls to decide what future specialties we cover, make sure you're subscribed. If you'd like to see what being a neurosurgeon looks like, check out my second channel, Kevin Jabal MD, where I do a second series in parallel called A Day in the Life. We'll be doing a day in the life of a neurosurgeon soon, and you don't want to miss it. Neurological surgery, or neurosurgery for short, is much more than just brain surgery. The nervous system is comprised of two main components, the central nervous system, or CNS, and the peripheral nervous system, or PNS. Try saying that one 5 times as fast as you can. The CNS includes the brain and spinal cord, whereas the PNS includes all other nerves within the body. Neurosurgery deals with surgical interventions of both. There are two overarching categories to neurosurgery: elective surgery and emergent surgery. Elective surgeries take place on a non-emergent basis and generally involve treating conditions that are not immediately life-threatening. They tend to fall into one of three categories: cranial surgery, spine surgery, and peripheral nerve surgery. Cranial surgery, as it sounds, involves operating on structures within the head, such as the brain. This category can be further subdivided into a few more subcategories: tumor surgery, vascular surgery, and functional neurosurgery. Tumors in the brain come in all shapes and sizes. They can be benign or malignant, slow or fast-growing, life-threatening or not. Some tumors can be observed without ever needing treatment, while others can be treated with radiation. But often, given the limited space afforded by the human skull and the sensitive nature of the brain's tissues, a neurosurgeon is called upon to surgically resect a tumor in the brain. Vascular neurosurgery involves treating abnormalities in blood vessels of the brain. Neurosurgeons might treat an aneurysm on a vessel or bypass a blockage or narrowing of a vessel, much the same way you would do coronary bypass on the heart. Functional neurosurgery is the sexy stuff, the science fiction of the field. In functional neurosurgery, the brain is viewed as one large, complicated electrical circuit, and neurosurgeons try to modulate the circuit to bring about a desired outcome. This might involve placing electrodes within the brain to stimulate certain structures, or creating lesions with radiation, ultrasonic energy, or simple thermal ablation to effectively turn off structures that might be causing problems for a patient. Within spine surgery, there are a few subcategories as well. We'll call them degenerative, scoliosis, and tumors. The vast majority of spine surgery is done to treat good old-fashioned wear and tear or degenerative disease of the spine. Within these degenerative processes, the spinal cord itself, or nerve roots exiting the spine, can become compressed, leading to pain and weakness. Surgeons often are required to decompress these structures by removing certain elements of the spine. When removing these bony arthritic spurs or degenerated discs, the integrity of the spine can become compromised, which can require a spinal fusion to restore stability, although the fused segment has increased rigidity. Spine surgery also includes repair of scoliosis, whereby curvature of the spine can become so severe as to cause pain, difficulty breathing, or other functional deficits. It's important to note that spinal decompression surgeries and scoliosis repair can be performed by either neurosurgeons or orthopedic surgeons. However, removal of tumors of the spinal cord is performed exclusively by neurosurgeons. While a tumor in the liver or breast can be relatively quickly resected, removing tumors around the spine can be quite involved and take a long time, even for small tumors, due to the care and precision required to leave the spinal cord uninjured. Peripheral neurosurgery, as the name suggests, involves operating on the peripheral nervous system. This includes all nerves outside of the brain and spinal cord. These nerves can sprout tumors or become injured in an accident. In such cases, a neurosurgeon may be called upon to remove that tumor, to reconnect severed nerves, or in some cases, to connect part of a healthy and working nerve to a damaged nerve in the hopes that a patient can regain function of that nerve over time. Now, if you're a trauma surgeon, you take shifts and handle traumas that come in on your shift. If you're a neurosurgeon, you have to operate on your scheduled cases, but also take neurosurgery trauma call on top. It's just part of the job. Compared to other parts of the body, the skull is a fixed space, which results in its own set of issues. If you bleed into your abdomen, you're concerned about exsanguination, meaning you can bleed out and die as your abdomen can distend to accommodate a large volume of blood. In the cranium, however, a fixed space means that as you bleed, pressure increases, resulting in compression of the brain. You won't ever exsanguinate, as the skull is too small, but brain bleeds are deadly due to brain herniation, meaning compression and pushing of critical structures through the foramen magnum outside the skull. Alleviating pressure is key, and this is done with a decompressive hemicraniectomy, meaning removing part of the skull to create space for the brain to swell after it has been injured. The excised segment is kept in the freezer, and neurosurgeons can put it back weeks or months later when the brain swelling has resolved. There are four main types of brain bleeds: epidural hematomas, subdural hematomas, subarachnoid hemorrhages, and intraparenchymal hemorrhages. Epi means above, and dural refers to the dura, the outermost layer of the meninges covering the brain. Epidural hematomas are bleeds most commonly from the middle meningeal artery in the space below the skull, but above the dura. With an arterial source, these bleed quickly and usually result from blunt trauma to the head. Subdural hematomas are below the dura and are more common amongst elderly patients on blood thinners. These are venous bleeds and slower in nature, but can be equally urgent and life-threatening. Subarachnoid hemorrhages result from an aneurysm rupturing, and because it's below the arachnoid layer of the meninges, the blood fills the sulci of the brain, meaning all the nooks and crannies, effectively coating the brain in blood, which can be toxic. Intraparenchymal hemorrhages are bleeds within the actual tissue of the brain, and this can result from long-standing hypertension resulting in arteriosclerosis or other reasons. Ruptured aneurysms are usually handled by neurosurgeons, but sometimes by endovascular surgeons or interventional radiologists. Treatment is either coil placement or placing a clip over the aneurysm. Intraparenchymal hemorrhages can sometimes be large enough that they need to be evacuated. In those cases, a neurosurgeon might make an opening into the skull and work their way down to the hematoma to evacuate as much blood as safely possible without damaging surrounding structures. If a patient fractures their spine, the spinal cord can become compressed or even severed. Urgent decompression is often required, as is stabilization to reduce additional uncontrolled movement and further injury. This is why you see C-spine collars placed on trauma patients, for stability and to reduce the risk of additional spinal cord injuries. To become a neurosurgeon, you'll have to complete neurosurgery residency after medical school. Neurosurgery has the longest residency start to finish, lasting 7 years in duration. Most residencies will include 1 year of dedicated research time, though not all. In terms of competitiveness, neurosurgery is consistently in the top five, in most recent years being ranked third, only behind dermatology and plastic surgery. Neurosurgery candidates are top students, with very high step 1 and step 2 scores, generally only a few points below the average dermatology or plastic surgery matriculants. But what truly sets neurosurgery applicants apart is their research. The average matriculant in 2018 pumped out over 18 publications, abstracts, or presentations by the time they applied to residency. In comparison, plastic surgery and dermatology were at 14, with orthopedic surgery at 10. Most other specialties didn't even break 7. So why the focus on research in neurosurgery? Neurosurgery is a highly academic field, likely due to the fact that there is so much room to improve outcomes in patients. Residency programs want to train surgeon scientists who will advance the field. While treatment modalities and outcomes have improved drastically in the past 20 to 30 years, there are several pathologies with bleak outcomes. For example, glioblastoma multiforme, or GBM for short, had an average prognosis of about 5 months over a century ago. Despite all the technological advancements since, these days, even after aggressive surgery, radiation, and chemotherapy, median survival has improved to only 14 to 16 months. Medical students that end up applying to neurosurgery are a unique bunch and are a self-selecting group. They take the meaning of workaholic to the next level. The award for most brutal and rigorous residency, even amongst surgical residencies, is usually reserved for neurosurgery. Despite the 80-hour work week restrictions enacted by the ACGME, it's not uncommon to see neurosurgery residents exceeding these limits repeatedly. After completing residency, you can practice as a general neurosurgeon or choose to subspecialize further with a fellowship. Skull Base is primarily concerned with tumors that grow along the base of the skull, which is notoriously high-end real estate. It's a shrinking field, mainly because less invasive options like radiosurgery and endovascular procedures are becoming more sophisticated and appealing for patients. Those with the best hands and stamina for 18-hour plus surgeries go here. It's a young man's game. Neurovascular is highly technical, dealing with aneurysms, hemorrhagic strokes, and bypassing blockages in the brain. Call schedule is brutal, attracting those who are gluttons for punishment. Outcomes can sometimes be particularly grim, which can take a toll over the course of one's career. You'll need a strong stomach. Functional and stereotactic surgery deals with modulating the electrical circuitry of the brain. These are the nerds of the nerds, usually with PhDs after their name or computer science backgrounds. Spine is for the jocks and ortho bros. There's a great deal of bony work, thus requiring a higher degree of strength and, on average, less finesse than other aspects of neurosurgery. Pediatrics is for the neurosurgeons who are best at dealing with parents. A strong stomach is prerequisite, as children needing neurosurgical intervention generally don't have rosy outcomes. Peripheral nerve is perhaps the smallest subspecialty within neurosurgery, partly because it's not exclusive to neurosurgeons, as you can get there through orthopedics or plastic surgery as well. It's for surgeons who enjoy operating all over the body, since the peripheral nervous system exists everywhere outside of the brain and spinal cord. Surgical neuro-oncology tends to attract surgeons with an interest in tumor biology. These surgeons may spend up to half of their time in the research lab, studying additional methods for tumor treatment beyond simple surgical resection. This is because a large subset of brain tumors don't respond to just surgical resection, like GBM. Trauma and neurocritical care is for those surgeons who wish to focus on the multidisciplinary treatment of patients with traumatic neurological injuries. Beyond performing life-saving surgeries, these folks are interested in the longer-term post-operative recovery process for patients suffering from traumatic brain injury, spinal cord injury, aneurysm rupture, or hemorrhagic stroke. As a neurosurgeon, you'll be working on arguably the most fascinating and mysterious organ in the body, the brain. Psychiatrists and neurologists deal with the brain as well, but in a non-surgical capacity. You'll get to touch, change, and augment the central nervous system right in front of you in real time. It's a highly innovative field, particularly the subspecialty of functional neurosurgery, where the line is blurred between what is you and what is hardware. It raises questions about free will, consciousness, and other questions that are bound to keep you up late at night. Only a few specialties truly save people's lives, and neurosurgery is one of them. And while the surgeries may become routine, the feeling of saving someone's life never will. Trauma and emergency medicine are some other specialties that share this aspect. Neurological surgery is a highly academic field, satisfying even the most intellectually curious. You'll be surrounded by driven and truly impressive colleagues cut from the same cloth. To quote my neurosurgery friend, not to say we're better than everyone, but we are. He's joking, of course, but not really. As a doctor, you normally need to choose between honing surgical expertise and foregoing medical management, or vice versa. That's one thing I did not enjoy about plastic surgery. I wasn't managing patients medically so much, just more so surgically. As a neurosurgeon, you'll be handling the medical side of things too. Titrating sedatives to adjust for intracranial pressure abnormalities, adjusting ventilator settings, and reading EEGs to see if someone is seizing. In medical school, I rotated on orthopedic surgery, plastic surgery, and neurosurgery, the three specialties I was considering most seriously. One thing I loved about neurosurgery were the personalities. Some of the funniest and coolest surgeons I worked with were, of course, neurosurgeons. This is not uncommon. The field is very humbling, and despite the stereotype, neurosurgeons are faced daily with the reality that they are not God. You cannot take yourself too seriously, and you will need to learn to laugh at yourself, otherwise you won't last. There were two main factors that pushed me away from neurosurgery, despite my love for neuroscience and my fascination with the brain. First, think about the types of patients that need neurosurgical intervention. They're very sick and can often have very poor outcomes. Many patients succumb to immense suffering or death. That may not sound so bad right now, but day after day, year after year, that sort of heaviness will weigh on you. The other thing that pushed me away from neurosurgery was learning that it wasn't as precise and meticulous as I would have expected brain surgery to be. Certain aspects are highly precise, like skull base, but much of neurosurgery is surprisingly crude and closer to something like orthopedic surgery rather than plastic surgery. But wait, there's more. Neurosurgeons face one of the most challenging lifestyles of any specialty, even beyond residency. That's because in addition to your scheduled cases, you'll need to take neurosurgery trauma call. In medicine, we say that neurosurgeons make the most money, but don't have any time to enjoy it. The median salary is $680,000 per year, and they're consistently number one or number two in terms of highest paid specialty, duking it out with orthopedic surgeons. The field is 92% men. While not as bad as orthopedic surgery, it's one of the most male-dominated specialties, although that is slowly changing. The neurosurgeon stereotype comes with good and bad. For online dating apps, it's great, but beyond that, the stereotype is difficult to deal with in the hospital. Others expect you to have a god complex, to be an asshole, egotistical, emotionless, or even sociopathic. At this point, you'll know whether or not neurosurgery is right for you. It's a highly self-selecting group of people. Obviously, you need to enjoy the practice of surgery and have deep intellectual curiosity for the brain and mind. But beyond that, you need to really want it more than anything else. You'll need incredible stamina to endure a brutal 7-year residency and continue to work challenging and unpredictable hours as an attending. The stakes are high, and there's a consistently high sphincter tone and level of vigilance. That's because, so often, patients with neurological injuries can be incredibly hard to monitor. A patient in acute organ failure, mid-heart attack, or exsanguinating during a trauma can be hard to ignore. But in neurosurgery, potentially devastating neurological complications, such as a stroke or a brain bleed, can occur with scary subtlety. Being on top of the ball is a must. If you're all about that, you'll certainly get the excitement and rush from the unpredictability of trauma. You'll also get the highly technical aspect of something like plastic surgery. If you take deep pride in your work and have perfectionistic tendencies, neurosurgery may be a good fit. Big shout out to the neurosurgeons at Med School Insiders who helped me in the creation of this video. If you are interested in becoming a neurosurgeon yourself, you'll need to be a top performing student. And who better to learn from and be mentored by than neurosurgeons themselves? If you need help acing your MCAT, USMLE, or other exams, our tutors can maximize your test day performance. If you're applying to medical school or neurosurgery residency, our neurosurgeons can share the ins and outs of what it takes and how to navigate the highly competitive process most effectively. Learn more and see why our customers love us at medschoolinsiders.com. Thank you all so much for watching. This one was particularly fun to make. What specialty do you want me to cover next? Leave a comment down below and make sure you are subscribed if you want to vote in those upcoming polls. If you enjoyed the video, hit that thumbs up button to keep the YouTube gods happy. Much love to you all, and I will see you guys in that next one.